कैसी?
Among all your valuable accomplishments, yeah. which should you consider as outstanding as a space scientist and as a president of India?
Well, I personally believe I always value as a teacher. I am a teacher. When my student got a PhD, that was the greatest happiness for me.
Okay.
Okay. Next day. Next day.
Welcome, dear friends. It is my signal honor to introduce a scholar, a researcher, a great human being, Father Dr. A.K. George, the only research scholar of Dr. A.P.J. Abdul Kalam, the Bharat Ratna. I would like to hear from Father George his experience with Dr. Kalam ji.
Ji.
Yeah, Father.
I'm very happy to speak about my guide, Dr. A.P.J. Abdul Kalam. He was a guide and a very great friend of mine too. He was very humane, very kind-hearted, and very gentle and broad-hearted. I had the rare opportunity to meet him when I was in Anna University, Chennai. I was told that Dr. Kalam had joined Anna University. And then my guide for M.Tech had told me to meet Dr. Kalam to do my PhD under him. And then I went to his place, that is called RCC in Anna University. And there, when I went, I found that there were a lot of people queued up already. I meekly joined at the rear end of the queue and waited. But it was a very long wait, about 3 hours I had to wait because there were a lot of people to meet him. And then finally I got a chance and I was about to enter his room. It was almost 5 o'clock in the afternoon, and then to my great disappointment I found Dr. Kalamji was coming out of the room. I had been actually preparing a sentence to tell him at the first meeting so that I can get a great impression. First impression being the great impression, I definitely prepared a sentence. Then seeing Dr. Kalamji coming out, and at the same time the secretary there was telling me that Dr. Kalam is going to Bangalore, is having a flight at 5:30. I was disappointed. I decided not to present my case before him because he was busy. But something very great happened as he came out. As he was coming out, without any air of greatness, he just came, then saw me standing there and looked at me like this and asked me, "Ah?" And then I did not know what to tell him. I did not want to present my case, and therefore I just said, "Good evening, sir." With that, I thought he is a busy man, he is to catch the flight, he would go, I thought, but he would not go. He was still standing there. He wanted to know why I was there. Then I knew maybe if I say I am an Anna University student, then he could ask me to come back again later. I said, "Sir, I am an Anna University student." But he was still looking at me like that. Why Anna University student here? Then I had nothing else to tell him. I had to say the statement that I had been preparing in my mind, and I started telling him. But in that excitement of meeting Dr. Kalam for the first time, I just forgot the statement at the middle of it. I was red with fear and shame, but then this Dr. Kalam was so busy at that time, still waiting patiently to hear from me to complete that statement. Anyhow, I gathered all my courage and started the sentence once again. But unfortunately, in the middle of it, I lost track of it. And I, by this time, was completely ashamed of, completely disappointed. And I was ready for any punishment. I thought he would get angry and he would possibly just go past me. But this great man was still looking at me. Why? What is that? With an expression of that. And then for a third time, I repeated my same sentence. Just like the primary students, they repeat the same multiplication table or the same poetry, they repeat. I repeated. He was listening to me. And then for a third time, I broke my sentence at the middle. Then I was ready for any punishment. I was completely ready there sheep to be slaughtered. But then he was so humane, so friendly, so nice, gentle-hearted. He told me, you sit. I was embarrassed. He was standing and he was busy and he was asking me to sit. And then I showed my reservation in my body language, how to sit when you are standing. But this man said, you sit. He was very magnanimous. He said, you sit. And then I sat. And the moment I sat on a chair, and the nearby chair, he pushed the chair towards me and then sat on that chair. And then he looked at my face and asked, what is your name? With that, what is your name? I immediately said, here I knew what to say. I said, I am Father George. The moment I said Father George, he said, are you a Jesuit? And then I said, no, I am a CMI, I said. He said, what is CMI? I said, Carmelites of Mary Immaculate. By the way, today is the feast of Immaculate Conception. Okay. And then he said, what is CMI? I said, Carmelites of Mary Immaculate. He said, immediately he began to say, I met your bishop. He again said, I met your bishop in Rajkot. A third statement, he said, I met your Bishop Grigory in Rajkot. The moment he said so much, then I was confident. And then he began to speak about that Christ College in Rajkot, where he had gone for a function, and the way the principal and the vice principal were managing that entire function, he began to say about it. And there he said, that vice principal is also a George, and he was actually managing the show. He said something, and finally he said, Father, now I am going to Bangalore. I will come back after a week. You come back after a week. The most important thing he said then, we will talk at length. He said, we will talk at length. Here I was not able to complete a sentence. And here he is reassuring me, saying, we will talk at length. That was Dr. Kalam. That day he impressed me so much. I know when my students are taking too much time to answer, or when they are not answering anything, the way I get angry. But this one, so great one, so busy, but was so nice, meek and gentle, humane, to assure me, reassure me that we will talk at length. This is Dr. Kalam, first experience of G.
It is always great to listen to a great man. Now, when he's speaking about a great man again, it's again a wonderful experience. I'm very happy to share with you, like Father A.K. George, who is with me today. He is currently the professor of computer engineering. So, Father, can you just tell about Kalamji, about how, how he used to guide you, how workaholic he was, and how friendly he was?
Okay. Regarding his friendliness, his workaholic nature and so on, I would like to say a few incidents. Obviously, there are many for me to share. One or two I will just share now. He had already become the president, and whenever he needs some clarification or some details about our project, he used to call me from Delhi and I used to respond. One day I was in the Anna University campus and he called me. He said, "Father, I am going to present something in some conference and you should give me a 2-page write-up of our project within half an hour." Oh, that was tough. And then I decided to go to my room. I told Kalamji that I am in the university campus now. I immediately go to my room and then I will write and then immediately send. But what happened was, as I was coming to my room in RCC, I found a man who was limping and he was half blind. He had an accident, and this man asked me to help him to reach another building in the Anna University campus, which is called Alagappa College. I was not having enough time, but because this man asked me, I decided to help him. And he was walking very slowly, step by step, and I was to go around 500 meters with him. I took the time, I went there and came back. By the time I came back, it was almost half an hour. And then came the call from Kalamji saying, "Father, is that ready?" I said, "Sir, please forgive me. I had another assignment like this. A person was limping and he was blind almost, and he asked me for help, and just now I have come back." I thought he would scold me. But what happened was, he said, "Father, in that case, please hold on. I will just give you something." And he went somewhere and he came with a small book, over the phone from Delhi, and he dictated to me some lines of poem, and that was from Emily Dickinson. And the poem was already, all that it was saying was, if I could feel with another one, if I can help a losing heart gain strength, if I can ease the pain of even a small bird, then my life is not in vain. This was the concept of that poem. He made me write, and over the phone it was difficult because many times I was not getting the proper word and he was to repeat multiple times, but he was patient enough. He said all these things, and then it was a great relief for me. Instead of scolding me, he was appreciating my action of charity. Then another case I will tell you, in the Anna University, how great a human being he was. We were walking through the roads of Anna University in the morning. And then, as we were walking, suddenly he patted on my shoulder like this and said, "Father, look at that, look at that, look at that." And I saw there was a man limping. He was limping. And he said, "Father, see that. See their pain." And then he said, "We should remove their pain. We should remove their pain." This is the way he was. Maybe for his, humane attitude, I will tell you one more incident. It just comes to my mind. He was already designated to be the president, and then a lot of people were coming to meet him. One day by around 9:30, he was coming to his RCC office, and then the moment he reached RCC office, he said like this, "Andha amma ange aluthitte irikkena, avare modale koopidunga," which means there was a long queue of people waiting for him, and at the end of the queue, there was a lady who was weeping, and he was yelling, "Call that lady who is weeping first." This is the way he was feeling with the people who are having suffering, having pain. Now, regarding the workaholic nature of Dr. Kalam, I will have to say this because I have seen and experienced very clearly. There in the Rashtrapati Bhavan, he used to call me very often. If there is an important person related to this project work is coming, or he is having some other presentation to be made, we wanted to discuss about our project, then he would call me. One day he called me, and then I went to his place. Night around 11 o'clock, I reached Rashtrapati Bhavan. And then I was asked to go to his personal study room. And then on meeting me, on seeing me, he began to ask about the project and the progress of it. And then meantime, he was also working on the papers on his table. It was a big deck of papers. And then he would read and then put it on one tray to the secretary, or sign it and put it in another tray, nothing more to be done, and so on. And then he will also ask me to explain the project, and he was multitasking like that. And then the deck of papers which was to be completed was big, and therefore at around 12 o'clock in the night, I asked him, "Sir, when will you stop reading these papers?" Pat came the reply. You know that? He said, "When this is over." That's it. Which means at least up to 3 o'clock or 3:30, he should have been working on that papers. Workaholic. Another day, say again in the Rashtrapati Bhavan, I was there, and this time he was there in a room called Technology Interface Room, where he prepares his speeches and he interacts with the experts over the net and so on. I went to that room, and then it was night around 11:30. The moment I entered the room, Dr. Kalam asked me, "Father, you had your dinner?" I said, "Yes." And then we continued, and he was actually reading from the projector screen, and he was suggesting ideas, and another one would be typing, and then in between, if he has got any doubt about the topic, he would immediately call people who are experts in that field. I still remember it. He was preparing a speech to be delivered in somewhere in Madhya Pradesh, and then night to 12:30, he had a doubt, and immediately the concerned expert in Madhya Pradesh was called over the phone. That was the way he was working there. And then around 1:30, suddenly Dr. Kalam, 1:30 night I say, suddenly Dr. Kalam got up and said, "Oh, you all had your supper. Let me have my supper." And then he went off. And at 1:30 he goes for supper and comes back. Comes back by around 2 o'clock or 2:15, and then continues with his work. This is the way Dr. Kalam was, workaholic. And he was ready to help everyone. I'm so happy to talk about Dr. Kalam. Ji.
We are also happy to hear about him. I also got an opportunity to listen to him in 2009 India. And of course, it was for some 20-30 minutes in Vishakhapatnam. But of course, listening about him in depth, it was an opportunity which you give. Father, the world is going through a pandemic. The researcher, we the faculty members, the students are all in a panic mode. What is your look at it?
That is right. You are right. Presently, the entire world is now going through a very difficult time. But then, what exactly shall we do is an important issue, is a question. To this, I am reminded of what Dr. Kalamji told once. He said in Tamil, "Ungaludaiya lakshyangalum nambikkaigalum sapnangalum thagarkkappadum bodhu andha chinaivugalkkidaiye thedi paarungal. Eedupaadugalkkulle pudaindhu kidakkum oru ponnana vaaippu ungal kannil padum." Which means, when your goals, dreams and trusts are shattered, look at the debris there. Hidden under them, you will find a golden opportunity. Grab it. And this is the same thing I feel on this occasion. This is a very difficult time. Our goals, our trusts, our dreams are all shattered. But you should understand, we should understand that necessity is the mother of inventions. When the world war was there, then a lot of inventions were there. And now we are going through a threshold. A lot of difficulties are there whereby we are going to find out techniques to survive over this. And this is an obstacle presented by us, by the nature, I don't know, by God or whatever it is. This is an opportunity and we will try to win over this. And there will be more, we will be more powerful. I remember the story that we had read, the story of the pupa. A doctor one day saw a pupa slowly opening up its shell and the butterfly inside was trying to come out of this pupa and it was taking a lot of stress and the doctor felt he should somehow help this butterfly. He, as a doctor, he went to his place and took a scalpel and very carefully operated on that shell and made this butterfly come out of the shell without any effort. But what happened was, it fell down. It could not fly because its wings were not big enough and its body was very heavy and it could not fly. And the ants came and took it away. The moral from that story was like this. If we want to be strong, if our hands are to be strong, if our minds are to be strong, we should have difficulties to work with. Why are you going to the gym? Only to take some weight? No, when you know that it is a weight and it is a difficult thing, but you know your muscles will become stronger. Very same way, when difficulties are there, our mind works better, brain works better for better solutions, and at the end of the day we will come stronger. Every difficulty is an opportunity, and I hope the entire world, including each and every one of us, will find new ways and become stronger because of this pandemic.
So with a mantra, where there is a will, there is a way. So thank you, Father Dr. A.K. George, to enlighten us about Abdul Kalam, his experience. This is just a beginning. So signing off with this beginning, this is Abronil Banerjee from Mechanical Engineering, St. Vincent Pallotti College of Engineering and Technology. Thank you.